Isaiah chapter 12. And in that day thou shalt say, O Lord, I will praise thee. Though thou wast angry with me, thine anger is turned away, and thou comfortest me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. The Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also has become my salvation. Therefore, with joy shall ye draw water out of the wells of salvation. And in that day shall ye say, Praise the Lord, call upon his name, declare his doings among the people, make mention that his name is exalted. Sing unto the Lord, for he hath done excellent things. This is known in all the earth. Cry and shout in the inhabitant of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel in the midst of thee.
Let's sing number 495. 495, we'll sing it through twice, and we will observe the holes or the bird's eyes. 495.
Thank you.
296.
Thank you.
pronounce?
239.
All right, 239. Brother Joey, you want to take over the second half? 239.
Thank you.
four, except for the last one.
Thank you. Sam will bow and ask Brother Pierre Anderson to lead us in prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, once again, we're about before we give up, thank you for what you know to say tonight. Keep us safe and all armed, you know, and pray for what you've been with us today. Continue to watch over, keep us safe, and pray for all of the prayer requests that have been made, unspoken, unspoken. We know that they can be different. Just pray for what they feel off from here today. And I see today there's a need for salvation before the time of today. Because as you think for the forgiveness, you stand for what you've been with, you have here to be prepared with the coming week. We pray for our country, pray for our leaders, dear Lord, and let us seek your guidance and your service to our country. We can do it. All that's going on there, we know, dear Lord, it's a little in your heart. We just pray, dear Lord, for that you forgive us, dear Lord, come in false spirit before coming tonight. We pray that we can serve you better in the future than we have in the past. We pray, dear Lord, that you go with us in the service. Keep us safe, bring us back to next point.
Sing number 360. Take her up. So Marissa said, he lives.
Of the ground which the Lord hath cursed. And the
Matt lived after he begot Noah 595 years, begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Matt were 777 years, and he died. And Noah was 500 years old, and Noah begot Shem, Ham, and Japheth. When we read these scriptures, we wonder, you know, these men were very elderly when they begot children. And some of them were on up beyond maybe what we consider the capability of human beings to reproduce children. And yet, God's able to do all things. There was not as much sickness in the land, in the world then, as there is now. And I know that sin is the original cause of sickness and death coming in the world. And I got for us this morning to think about Enoch. And Enoch being a type of the rapture. Jared, we're told, lived 962 years old. In other words, 962 years old. And Enoch did not live nearly that long. He just lived 365 years. And then his son lived longer than all of Methuselah. He lived 969 years old. If someone tells you you look as old as Methuselah, that'd be an insult. I believe, but Methuselah may not have looked as old as we think it is, since people didn't die as young back then. But as I think about Enoch and him being a type of the rapture, I want us to think about, first of all, that God, in his infinite wisdom, and in the grace of God, that he made a way for all men to have salvation. Even from Adam down to the day when Jesus died on the cross, and up until our day, and until the coming of the Lord, that salvation comes through the blood of Jesus Christ. Those who lived before Jesus came to this world, they believe that he would come, that he would give his life for their sins. And of course, those of us who lived since that time, we believe that he did indeed come and give his life for your sins and mine. And so, the day of grace came in Enoch's life when he was approximately 65 years old. He had an encounter with God. I wonder when your encounter with God came. And I'm not talking about just a casual encounter. I'm talking about a significant time, a time that you've never had in your life before, that when you came to know him, that you put your faith and your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I heard someone say the other day that they did not write down the day that they were saved, the date, but they remember a time in their life when they trusted Jesus as their Savior. And so there was a time in Enoch's life when his faith was placed in the Lord. Well, there was a time of great spiritual darkness upon the earth during this time. There was no church. There was no Bible. And as we think about the time in which they live, you know, God's blessed us to have his word before us that we can pick up and we can read on a daily basis. He blessed us that he placed his church here in this world, and that we can love him and worship him in his church, and that we can serve him in spirit and in truth. So even though that we see some dark days in our lives, even though we see some perilous times in our days, yet we still are blessed of God to enjoy his great blessings. Were it not for the blessings of God, that I don't know what we'd do. I know that I must have the blessings of God in my life every day. And I'm sure you feel the same. Well, the testimony that Enoch had was that he walked with God. Not saying a mouthful, isn't it, to say that a man walks with God. You'd have to walk very closely with him to be able, for it to be said of you that you're walking with God. And in verse 24, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Well, I've already mentioned the day in which he lived. And this is all leading up to the flood that came. It was a day of great wickedness. There was lawlessness. There was lust on every hand. There was marrying and giving in marriage to the day that Noah entered the ark. That is, marrying and divorcing and remarrying. And of course, living outside the bonds of holy matrimony. They were living the things of God out of their lives. They were more intent on making a success in life than being successful spiritually. And there was the imagination of the hearts of men were only evil continually. And so man had his thoughts on evil things. Just as we see today, that there's much evil in the world today. And Satan, of course, is the cause of all of this. And I'm not going to preach a message this morning on Satan, but we know that he was the most beautiful angel that God created. And that he rose up in pride against God in heaven. God had removed him from heaven, and he came down to this earth, and he brought angels with him when he came down here. Now, he has been proclaimed to be the God of this world. You say, well, I thought God was the God of this world. Not now. Satan is the God of this world. He controls most of the things that happen in this world today. And it were not for the hindrance of the Holy Spirit of God, that things would be much worse than they are. And one day when he raptures the church out of here and Satan's turned loose and his influence, this world's going to completely go to pot. Excuse the expression, but it's going to get a lot worse than it is now. It's going to get so bad that men will run to the rocks and the mountains and cry out for the rocks and the mountains to fall on them, to hide them from the face of him who is sending that wrath upon this earth. There was a message of warning in all of this. 273 times in the New Testament, the Lord is coming is mentioned. 273 times. So it must be an important subject. And when I hear skeptics say, well, I'm such and such years old and he hasn't come yet. I remember my dad, and you all know the story about my dad's conversion, but before he was saved, he said, I'm 30-something years old, and I've heard about the coming of the Lord all my life. He hasn't come yet. Well, I've heard about it all my life, too. And he hasn't come yet, but that doesn't mean that he's not coming. You see, we don't know the day nor the hour. It was not given unto man to know. It was not given unto the Son to know. Not even Jesus knows of the day nor the hour that God's going to send him. But when God gives the order, Son, go get my people, he's going to come. And whatever he's doing, in that particular moment, he'll lay it down. And he'll come immediately. He won't procrastinate. He won't say, wait a few minutes. Wait till tomorrow. Wait till next week. Wait till next year. He'll come immediately. and God calls for him to come. And so, see, it would behoove all of us, whether we know Christ or whether we do not know Christ, to be ready for his coming. In Jude, there's only one chapter, of course, in the little book of Jude, and I'd like for us to turn over there and read a couple of verses in the book of Jude. And the verses that I want us to read are verses 14 and 15. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints. So even Enoch prophesied the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the purpose, to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all of their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Who is him? Lord. We think about an ungodly person as being someone evil and mean and so on. Not necessarily. If you don't know God, you're ungodly. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, my friend, you're ungodly. Because you're not a child of God. Enoch knew the Lord well. And one day as he was walking with God, and I'm putting this maybe in human terms where we can understand it, God said, let's go to my house. So God and Enoch went to heaven. He went with God to heaven. Enoch was not anymore walking upon the face of this earth. Revelation, the sixth chapter, we read about when the sixth seal is broken. And I made reference to this a few months ago, that people would run to the rocks and to the mountains and cry out for the rocks and the mountains to hide, to fall on them, and to hide them from the face of him that sitteth upon the throne. Can you imagine that? Yes, there's going to be, you know, we've seen some very tragic things happen in war from time to time. We've heard about what happened in Gaza. We heard about what's happened in various places in the world. We've seen man's inhumanity to man. We've witnessed that through the news media. And that, I know that we have some veterans in the congregation here, and some of them have already gone to be with the Lord. And if you never looked at the hanging on the wall down this hall, you need to walk down there one day and look at it. Brother Albert put that together, and pictures of those who served in the military, the armed forces of our nation, and put their lives in jeopardy in the defense of our freedom. And many young men have given their lives on the battlefield to defend freedom. Not on the battlefield, but in the air and on the sea, to protect our liberty. But that's going to pale in comparison to what's going to happen, the Battle of Armageddon. Are you ready? Enoch walked with God and was not. Went to be with the Lord. There came a sudden change in his life. You know, I preached here not long ago about King Hezekiah. How that the message was delivered unto him by Isaiah that you're going to die, not me, and you need to set your house in order. And that we need to set our houses in order, our spiritual houses in order, that we might be prepared, that we might be ready for the coming of the Lord. And even more so, that if death claims us unexpectedly, we go to be with him. In the 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews, we're told that Enoch was not found. They looked for him. Can you imagine his family looking for him? Searching high and low. Where's Enoch? Where's Daddy? Where's Granddad? We've looked everywhere. We can't find him. And finally, probably, they called off the search. Because they didn't know what had happened to him. Look and look and look. But he could not be found. When the rapture takes place, when Jesus comes in the clouds, will you be caught up in the rapture with God's people? If not, you'll be left behind. Think about in homes. Suddenly, one parent, both parents, disappeared. Nowhere to be found. Think about the highways and the streets. Cars running together. I know they're making cars now that can drive themselves, but you know, there's still plenty of them around that don't. A pilotless plane. I know they have autopilot on planes and modern technology. But that plane's got to come down sooner or later. It can't stay in the air forever. If it runs out of fuel, it's coming down the hard way. It's going to crash. What about the people on that plane who are unsaved, who are not ready to meet the Lord? Perhaps the pilot, co-pilot knew the Lord, and they were caught up in the rapture. Eventually that plane falling to the earth and killing the people on that plane. I go on and on describing very difficult situations. Maybe a child coming in from school. And I remember when I used to come in from school, my mother used to have something ready for me to eat. It didn't matter if it was a cold biscuit and a tater, as old say it goes, but she'd have something for me to eat. And I'd hit that back door running because I knew there was something there waiting for me to eat. But you know, if I'd run in and I couldn't have found her anywhere in that house, the car sitting out in the yard. Go running all over the farm and couldn't find her anywhere. Began to call around neighbors' houses and the phone was not being answered. I probably would have gone into hysterics. You know, when I was lost. Because after I was saved, I was going up with her. She got caught up in the rapture. But now, I'm not trying to use this to try to frighten folks into joining the church. Don't get me wrong. I want you to face reality as it is. To realize that Enoch was ready. And the day that God came and walked with him and took him home with him, there was no lingering. There was no waiting. He went immediately. He said, well, why didn't the Lord let him go home and tell his wife, his children, and family about the goodbye? The Lord has a reason in all things that he does. When Jesus comes, will someone be looking for you? I hope they will, because I hope you'll not be here. If Jesus came right now, with this church completely empty, well, those who are unbelievers, those who have failed to trust in Jesus as their Savior would be left behind. All the rest of us would go up. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. That's pretty quick, isn't it? How long does it take you to bat your eye? A millisecond? He walked with God, and he was not. For God took him. One day you're going to be taken out of this world. Are you prepared to go? Have you made your preparation? Yes, it's good to make final arrangements, make preparations for those. Leave instructions behind your family as to what you want done when you do leave this world. It's good to have a place of burial. It's good to know which funeral home that you want to do your service. It's good to have someone written down to conduct your funeral service. Who you want to sing, who you want to play, all that sort of thing. That's all well and good. It needs, and all of us need to do it. But if we don't do any of that, if we prepare to meet Jesus, that's the most important thing of all. Because when he comes in the clouds, it's not going to make any difference how much that casket cost that body's in. It's not going to make any difference if it's in a concrete vault. If God can open the sea and let Israel cross on dry land, if he can allow a whale to swallow Jonah and Jonah survive that ordeal, he can certainly bust up a concrete tomb. Are you ready? In a few minutes, we'll dismiss and we'll go our separate ways. We'll go to our homes or wherever we're going. I don't give a second thought about it, because that's what we plan to do. But plans are subject to change. If you're not ready to meet the Lord, all other plans that you make are secondary. That's the most important preparation you need to make. Yes, Enoch was not found. He was not. For God took him. God calls you out. You be ready. Where will you be going? Will you be going to a place that is eternal? To a place where Jesus has prepared for all those who trusted in him? are you going to a place that, first of all, is prepared for Satan and his angels? By man's own volition that he chose to sin, transgress God's law, and so when he died spiritually that day, all men after him would die spiritually unless they reached out and received the grace of God by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you ready? Are you ready? The songwriter said, are you ready for the judgment day? Are you ready when God calls? The songwriter said, when he calls me, I'll fly away. That soul will fly away. In closing today, Enoch being a type of the rapture, this is the only time that I find that a man was called away in the same manner that he was, in exactly the same manner. A man walking with God. He said, well, what about one of the prophets that was called away in a chariot of fire and so on? Well, the Bible doesn't say that he was walking with God, does it? Although I believe he was. But it said of Enoch that he was not, for he walked with God. So as we ask for a verse of an invitation to him, begging this morning, if you're not ready to meet the Lord, and you prepare to do so, when your time comes, that you would go to be with the Lord. We stand and sing. You come.